6.6 Work and Wages, the Labor Discipline Model. Before going through this section, let me give you an overview of this model. Every job market has two sides. On the one side, there are workers, and on the other side, there are employers. Employers offer wage to workers, and in return, they expect the workers to carry out certain tasks and put a lot of effort into their job. However, at the other end, the workers decide how much effort that they're going to put into their job depending on the wage that is offered to them. Now let's pause and go back and look at the situation from a perspective of the employer. Of course, any employer wants to make sure that the workers put 100% of their effort into their job. They can do this potentially by doing different things. For instance, they can specify all the things they expect the workers to do in their contract from day one. Or they can visually monitor the performance of their workers or ask the workers to fill out reports of what they've done to them on a daily basis. But all these methods are very costly and sometimes impossible depending on the nature of the job. For instance, when it comes to computer programming, you cannot specify all the things you expect from a programmer in the contract from day one, or you cannot visually or daily monitor the performance of a programmer. It doesn't make sense. Therefore, there is a better way for the employers to motivate their workers to work hard. And that way is to give them high enough wages to increase the employment rent for the workers. What do I mean by that? Let's assume I am a computer programmer for the Google. If Google offers me a wage that is much higher to the other competitors, let's say Facebook and Apple, then I have an incentive to make sure that the Google does not fire me and I don't lose my jobs. So I have an incentive to work hard. I know that my boss in Google may not be able to monitor my performance on a daily basis, but I know that in the long term, he or she can figure out whether I'm putting a lot of effort into my job or not. So I have an incentive because of high wages, because of employment rent that Google is offering me to work hard. Now, with these insights in mind, we're going to go back to our model and analyze the labor market from the perspective of the employee, from a perspective of worker. Here we have an example of one worker, Maria, and we're going to talk about her best response curve. The x-axis represents the hourly wage that is offered to Maria by her boss, and the y-axis represents the level of effort that Maria decides to put into her job depending on the wage that is offered to her. If she puts 100% of effort, we represent this by 1. Now, the key information here is Maria's reservation wage. If she decides to stay at home or not to work at all, she gets paid $6 per hour. So, in order to stay motivated and work hard, she has to be offered a wage that is at least higher than $6 per hour. This is Maria's best response curve. At the beginning, this curve is very steep, but as the hourly wage and the effort level increases, this curve becomes flatter. Why that's the case? Because we have to remember that there is this utility associated with increasing your effort level. Pushing yourself to work harder is unenjoyable. Let's assume that I'm putting 10% of effort into the job. Here, I can be motivated to push myself to work harder with a small increase in wages. But the story is different when I reach to 80% of level of my effort. If I put 80% of effort into my job, pushing myself to work harder becomes much, much more unenjoyable. Therefore, I have to be compensated by a bigger increase in wages. In other words, the higher the effort level it becomes more unenjoyable to push yourself to work harder. Therefore, you have to be compensated by a higher increase in wages. And that's why this curve has this shape. And we call the slope of these curves, which is declining, the marginal rate of transformation, transforming hourly wage into effort level. Now let's look at the labor market from a perspective of an employer. Let's scroll down and go to 6.7, wages, effort, and profits in the labor discipline model. Imagine that I'm an employer. I want to maximize my profit. How do I do that? I try to make sure that I get the maximum effort possible out of the wage that I'm paying to my workers. How does that work? Let's scroll down and use the same graph as before, but think about the situation from an employer's perspective. The x-axis is the wage that I pay to my workers, and the y-axis is the effort that they're willing to put into their job. Now, I imagine a scenario in my head as an employer. One scenario is that I pay $10 per hour and the worker puts 0.45 units of effort. Now, if I draw a line here, all the dots that exist in this line have the same effort to wage ratio. They give me the same profit. So therefore, I'm indifferent about all these dots in this line. And we call this line an isocost line. I can think about other scenarios as well, or other isocost lines. Let's focus on this line. The slope of this line is less. So therefore, it gives me less profit. Why? Because for the same wage that I paid before, I get a lower effort in this line. What's the most profitable line here? This one, of course. It is the most steeper line. It gives me the highest effort per wage. If I pay the same wage as before, in this scenario, I get a higher effort. So as an employer, naturally, I want to move to an isocost line, which is steeper. And here we call the slope of the line the marginal rate of substitution. In other words, my willingness to increase wages to motivate my workers to work harder. So far we started about analyzing the labor market from a perspective of a worker. Then we moved to the labor market from a perspective of an employer. Now, we're going to talk about the equilibrium. Equilibrium happens when the willingness of the worker matches the willingness of the employer. So let's scroll down. To analyze the equilibrium, let's still imagine I'm the employer, and now this time there's a real worker on the other side, Maria. I offer a wage to Maria, and Maria decides how much effort she's going to put into her job depending on the wage. This is Maria's best response curve. Remember, as an employer, I don't see this curve. I only offer a wage to Maria and can observe her effort every once in a while in the medium term. Remember, I cannot observe Maria's effort on a daily basis, but in the medium term, I can tell whether she's putting effort into her job or not. So as an employer, I offer a wage which is just a little bit above the reservation to Maria, and Maria starts working and puts this level of effort into her job, point C. But then after a while, I realize that if I increase Maria's wage, she is willing to put more effort into her job, and this makes more profit for me. Why? Because the pace of the increase in her effort is higher the pace in increase in wages. I repeat, the pace in increase in her effort is higher the pace in increase in her wages until point A. All right. Here I make the most profit. Now, Of course, A is more profitable than C. Why? Because if we go back to our iso-cost line, C lies in a line which is costlier than this line. Of course, I wished I could move to this line, which is the lowest cost line out of three, but that's beyond Maria's willingness to work. So the equilibrium is A. Here, my willingness to pay higher wages for higher effort matches Maria's willingness to work harder for the higher wage. Now, in the end, let me end with this question. Now, how does this equilibrium change if suddenly a recession hits and the unemployment shuts up?